A very good evening, aspirants. Welcome to the Hindu newspaper analysis brought to you by Shankar IAS Academy for the date 3rd of December 2021. We have taken four articles today for our discussion. I'll give you a brief about them one by one. The first article, it is about queer community. In that discussion, we are going to see what is sexual orientation and gender identity, and we'll finally end the discussion with some of the measures to make the public spaces inclusive for the queer community. The second article is about air pollution in the National Capital Region. We have discussed extensively about the causes of air pollution in Delhi region in the analysis 23rd of November. So if you want to refer to it, please refer the 23rd November analysis for the causes of it. In this discussion, we are going to see the UNEP, that is United Nations Environment Programme's review about Beijing's air pollution control measures. And we are going to see what are the key takeaway points from that for India. And the third article is about Paika Rebellion. In this discussion, we are going to see some of the historical background of it from prelims point of view. And finally, the fourth article is about population control measures. In that, we are going to see about total fertility rate and the data which is recently shown in National Family Health Survey 5, and we are going to see some of the effective population policy measures. So without any delay, we'll get into the discussion. The news article mentions about a public discussion that was held by NGO, which is a non-profit organization. So what was the discussion about? The discussion was about making public spaces LGBTIQ inclusive. So in this discussion, the NGO, they provided some suggestions to make public spaces inclusive for queer people. What we are going to do in this discussion is, we are going to take this article as a background and we are going to see about queer community and the challenges faced by them. See, in our world, people have different sexual orientation and gender identity. I'll tell you what are they. When I say sexual orientation, it refers to the romantic attraction, emotional or sexual attraction to others. So basically, sexual orientation is decided by whom you are attracted to. So it includes heterosexual, lesbian, gay, bisexual, asexual, etc. Here I'm saying etc. because sexual orientation is not just limited to these five categories. We'll see what these terms mean after understanding gender identity. So what is gender identity? To understand this, we need to know what is sex. So I'll give you the simplest definition of it. Sex refers to the genetic characteristics and physical body characteristics with which people are born. So basically, the biological and anatomical characteristics with which they are born. And based on these characteristics, people are labeled male or female at birth. So sex is a term related to a person's external anatomical features. Here, we should remember that sex is not always straightforward, as some people may be born with an intersex variation. I'll explain intersex. See, intersex are the people who are born with reproductive or sexual anatomy that does not fit the typical definitions of male or female. So this is about sex, and most importantly, know that this term sex is different from that of gender, because gender refers to the social and cultural expression of sex. It is a social construction relating to behaviors and attributes based on labels of masculinity and femininity. See, gender identity is a personal, internal perception of oneself. And so the gender category someone identifies with may not match the sex they are assigned at birth. See, sometimes individuals may see themselves as man. Sometimes individuals may see themselves as woman. So gender is not the biological sex people are born with. Remember this crucial difference. What is that difference? Sex is the genetic and physical body characteristics, but gender is social and cultural expression of sex. How a particular person is perceiving themselves. Now this gender identity, it refers to an inner sense of oneself as being man, woman, masculine or feminine, or an inner feeling of neither masculine or feminine, at times both masculine and feminine, etc. There is one another difference here. Note that gender identity is not sexual identity and it is not related to an individual's sexual orientation. So gender identity includes cisgender, transgender, non-binary. But sexual orientation, it has to do with romantic emotional attraction to others. The definitions of some of these terms are given in this image. Please go through it for your better understanding. So far, we saw what is sex, which is nothing but genetic physical body characteristics with which people are born. And we saw some of the sexual orientations. Sexual orientation is nothing but to whom you are romantically or emotionally attracted to. People are categorized as heterosexual, homosexuals such as lesbian, gay, based on their sexual orientation. Bisexuals also comes under the category of sexual orientations. And lastly, we saw gender identities. Gender identity is the social and cultural expression of oneself, how the individual is pursuing themselves, be it man or woman, or having masculine or feminine characteristics, at times both, at times neither masculinity nor femininity. Now together, these sexual orientations and gender identities are combined under the label of LGBTIQ+. Each letter refers to different terms. We'll see them one by one. L for lesbian, G for gay, B for bisexual, T for transgender, I for intersex, Q for queer, and plus includes all other sexual orientations and gender identities. So moving on, we'll see what is queer. It is a term that includes a range of sexual orientations and gender identities. It is often used as an umbrella term to describe the LGBTIQ+ identities. This term also encapsulates the political ideas of resistance to heteronormativity and homonormativity. We'll understand what are these terms. First of all, we'll try and understand what is heteronormativity. It is nothing but the presumption and privileging of heterosexuality. That is, the view that heterosexual relationships are the only natural, normal, and legitimate expressions of sexuality and relationships. Therefore, it assumes that other sexualities or gender identities are unnatural and a threat to society. So the name itself explains that it is a mentality that considers being hetero is the only normal thing. So you have to understand here why such a mentality is there in the first place. It is because of the proportionality. A larger portion of the society has identified themselves as heterosexuals, and that is why this kind of a mentality is prevailing in the society. Now we shall move on and see what is homonormativity. Homonormativity is a term that describes the privileging of certain people or relationships within the queer community itself. That is usually privileging cisgender, white, gay men, etc. And others in the queer community are left out of the privileges. This homonormativity, this term, also refers to the belief that sexual minorities such as cisgender, gay men, lesbians, they can and should conform to the heteronormative institutions and customs in order to achieve greater acceptance into the dominant society. So this is also a belief under homonormativity. Now we will see what are the challenges faced by queer people. The first two challenges are heteronormativity and homonormativity, which we have discussed now. Next is homophobia, biphobia, transphobia. These are major social problems. Phobia is nothing but fear. And they also refer to negative beliefs, prejudices, and stereotypes that exist about people who are not heterosexual. See, again here, the reason why I said heteronormativity is existing in the first place is because a larger proportion in the society is being heterosexual. So as a result of heterosexism, these negative beliefs, prejudices and stereotypes are existing. Heterosexism is nothing but a social system which privileges heteronormative beliefs, values and practice. These homophobia, biphobia and transphobia is what leads to violence, harassment and discrimination against the queer people. Because of this, many countries even criminalize homosexuality and queer people. So they are punished by fines, imprisonment and even death penalty. If you remember, our country also had Section 377 of IPC, which is nothing but Indian Penal Code. This section criminalized homosexuality and provided punishment of imprisonment for life. But in the year 2018, in a historic verdict, the Supreme Court decriminalized the Section 377 of IPC and allowed consensual gay sex among adults. This verdict upheld the fundamental rights under Article 14, Article 15 and Article 21. Due to the above discussed challenges, queer people are socially ostracized, which is nothing but they are excluded from the society. They are even sometimes evicted from their own houses. Another major challenge is access to public spaces, as discussed in this news article. The public spaces are not accessible because they are mostly designed with a heteronormative approach, again because of the proportion of them in the society. For instance, take public toilets. We have separate toilets for men, we have separate toilets for women in public spaces. But there is no gender neutral toilets for those who do not identify as these genders or who identify themselves as transgender or as both genders. These problems lead to the higher rates of mental health issues like depression, anxiety and suicide among queer people. So to address these challenges, first of all, the public should change their attitude and should avoid stigmatizing language against queer people. Public should be educated to accept and treat queer people respectfully. Additionally, there is a need to prioritize designing and transforming the public spaces that are inclusive and safe for queer people. So government can build gender-neutral toilets in addition to the existing ones. Government can also take measures to degender the toilets in other public spaces like restaurants and planes and in trains. So with this, we have come to the end of our discussion. Let's have a quick recap. First of all, we saw what is sex, which is genetical and physical body characteristics with which people are born. And we understood what is sexual orientation, that is, to whom you are romantically or emotionally attracted to. Based on that, individuals are categorized as homosexuals, such as lesbian, gay, etc. And lastly, we saw what is gender identity. How a particular individual is identifying himself or herself. From that, we went on to see queer community and the challenges faced by them. And finally, we saw some points to make public spaces inclusive for the queer community. With this learned points in mind, let's move on to the next discussion. This news article is about the air pollution in NCR, that is National Capital Region. See, the author says that experts frame environmental concerns in technical terms such as pollutants, their monitoring systems and mechanisms, and penalties, whereas air pollution in cities is driven by urban form and transport infrastructure. So there is this gap between addressing the environmental concerns, according to the author. And the solutions for this environmental concerns depend on the different stages of development. So for this reason, the author is saying that UNEP's review of air pollution control measures by Beijing will help India. So UNEP, that is United Nations Environment Program, it has reviewed the air pollution control measures by Beijing, and the author is saying that it will help India in addressing the urban air pollution in National Capital Region. As per the article, the NGT, which is National Green Tribunal, has also started the process of taking a new look about the concern. So this is the crux of this article. Now we'll move on to discuss the review by United Nations Environment Program. The syllabus related to this topic is given here for your reference. Please make a note of it. Okay. Now, this entire article, which is about taking insights from Beijing's air pollution control measures, is based on the fact that Delhi and Beijing are comparable. China's capital city, which is Beijing, is comparable with India's capital city, which is Delhi, in terms of population. Hence, knowing the nuances of Beijing's measures to control air pollution would be of great value for India. So this entire article is based on this foundation, which is both the cities are comparable. Some other similarities are also there. We'll see them. Delhi shares with Beijing the three stages in dealing with urban air pollution. And for the both of them, it is a long-term task. So the task of dealing the urban air pollution for both the cities, it starts with end of pipe air pollution control measures. I'll explain it to you what it is. It describes a pollution control approach that remediates contaminated flows of air just before the effluent can enter the environment. I'll give you an example. Let us consider flue gases from industries or thermal power plants. See here, coal is used for combustion. From the boiler, steam is getting generated and it is led into the turbine, and as a result, power is generated. The byproduct of the whole process, or the outcome of the whole process, is this flue gas production. So this flue gas is going into the environment. What we are going to do is, just before it enters the environment, we are having this whole process, whole sets of process, such as denitrification, de-dusting, desulfurization, to remediate the contaminated flow of gas. This is only called as end of pipe air pollution control approach. So the flue gas, before getting released into the environment, it is denitrified, de-dusted, desulfurized, and ash is stored separately, and it is finally emitted into the environment. So the three stages of dealing urban air pollution, it starts with this end to pipe approach, and it gradually moves to integrated measures targeting primary pollutants such as sulfur dioxide, nitrous oxides, particulate matters, carbon monoxide, carbon dioxide. This targeting measure is done with the government playing the main role. So as a first step, what we are doing, we are remediating the contaminated gases before it enters the environment. As a second step, what we are doing, there will be pollutants which are already emitted into the environment. They are called as primary pollutants. They will be staying in the environment. So we are going to target those primary pollutants that are already in the environment. And moving on, finally, secondary pollutants or the particulate matter, primarily PM2.5, which leads to smog, becomes the main focus for control with the regional coordination mechanism. So first of all, we saw end-to-pipe approach, treating the flue gas before letting into the environment. Secondly, we are treating the pollutants which are already in the environment. And thirdly, there will be certain pollutants which, after letting into the environment, will change into another form. Here, the example is particulate matter leads to smog. So it becomes the secondary pollutant. So as a final stage, we are concentrating on the secondary pollutants with a regional coordination mechanism. And these are the three stages of dealing urban air pollution. So looking at the similarities in the control measures of both the cities, it will be useful for the policymakers in India to formulate an action plan based on Beijing's air pollution control measures. Now coming on to the differences that made Beijing stand better. We are going to see them one by one. Firstly, the strong monitoring capacity, which provides a warning at least 24 hours in advance during heavy pollution. This is done with an integrated network combining high-resolution satellite remote sensing and laser radar. This provides air, land data for accurate identification of high-emission areas and periods. Periods in the sense time duration. So basically what has been done is, with the remote sensing data, high-emission areas are monitored and a warning is provided in advance during heavy pollution, at least 24 hours in advance. Secondly, the control was made through an idea of smart cities that provide more space for public transport. So what really made a difference is not shutting down the polluting units, not restricting car ownership and travel, and improved fuel standards, but the approach to urbanization. Smart cities such as Newark, London, Beijing provide more space for public transport and mixed land use spatial planning, minimizing travel. So we'll see some data related to it. Beijing already has 550 kilometers of metro, more than 1.5 times that of the Delhi metro. And the bus transport system has 30,000 low flow buses, which is more than 8 times the number with the Delhi Transport Corporation. In China, 72% of travel is completed by public transport, compared with 37% in Japan, 17% in Europe, and 10% in United States. And we saw about spatial planning also. So the spatial planning of land use reduces the time and distance of travel. Moving on, the third one is increasing the use of electric vehicles. When it comes to air pollution, particulate matter is the most difficult to control. It leads to smog and serious health issues. It is largely caused by vehicular emissions. And one more thing, traffic has been identified as a distinct and growing challenge. So the systematic study on PM2.5 source apportionment in Beijing has found that local emissions constituted 2/3 of air pollution, of which vehicular emissions were nearly half the main source. So it has been found that phasing out the older vehicles made the most significant contribution to reduce air pollution. In the lights of encouraging alternative methods, Beijing plans to have 48 lakh charging points by 2022 to push the use of electric vehicles. Okay, now let's move on to the next point. The fourth one is increasing the efficiency in regulating the emission of air pollution. So this is ensured by specific enforcement mechanism like upgradation of industrial processes and equipments, because of which the air pollution contribution is high and the efficiency is increased by providing specified incentives for low or no emissions. Adding to this, enforcement at the municipal and state levels is coordinated, with each level having different responsibilities and a mechanism for cooperation. Municipal environmental enforcement teams do specific inspections in the sites and they do supervision also based on a detailed emission inventory for each source, and they pass the serious cases to the state level. So from the municipal level, serious cases are getting passed to the state level. What are the municipal enforcement teams doing? They are doing inspections and supervision. So these are some of the points which increases the efficiency in regulating the emission of air pollution. And the final one, the last one, is a set of measures which involves doing independent evaluations and once in a while reviewing the air quality management system and conducting quantitative assessments of the pollution reduction effects in the selected areas. Adding to this, analyzing new challenges. There is no assurance that the challenges will stay the same. New challenges will keep on coming, so once in a while you have to analyze new challenges also, and providing recommendations for enabling further improvement in air quality, and finally building public support. So that's it for the article. Let's have a quick recap. We saw the similarities between two cities in addressing the urban air pollution, which involved three stages. First one is end of pipe approach. The second stage is targeting primary pollutants, and the third stage is targeting secondary pollutants. And with that as a base, we saw the control measures taken in Beijing, which are having strong monitoring capacity and the idea of smart cities that provide more space for public transport. Thirdly, providing an alternative or supporting an alternative, which is the use of electric vehicles. Fourth one is increasing the efficiency in regulating the emission of air pollution, involving enforcement teams in the municipal and state level. And finally, doing independent evaluations, reviewing the management system, conducting quantitative assessments of the effects in selected areas, analyzing new challenges, providing recommendations, and building public support. So the discussion is important from the mains perspective. From prelims perspective, we'll understand about National Green Tribunal very briefly. NGT is an open court established under National Green Tribunal Act 2010. NGT has necessary expertise to handle all civil cases relating to environmental issues. It is guided by the principles of natural justice. Natural justice is nothing but to make a sensible and reasonable decision-making procedure on a particular issue. The decision of the tribunal has binding power and it can be reviewed by itself. And it can be challenged before Supreme Court also. Now let's see the functions of NGT. NGT disposes cases relating to environmental protection, conservation of forests and other natural resources. It enforces any legal right relating to environment. It has the power to give relief in the form of compensation for affected persons. So who all constitute NGT? The tribunal is headed by a chairperson and it has at least 10 but not more than 20 judicial members, and it also has at least 10 and not more than 20 expert members. Moving on, we'll see some of the statutes covered under NGT. The Water Prevention and Control of Pollution Act 1974, the Water Prevention and Control of Pollution CESS Act 1977, the Forest Conservation Act 1980, the Air Prevention and Control of Pollution Act 1981, the Environment Protection Act 1986, the Public Liability Insurance Act 1991, the Biological Diversity Act 2002. NGT has not been vested with powers to hear any matter relating to Wildlife Protection Act 1972 and the Indian Forest Act 1927. So that's it for the National Green Tribunal. Let's have a quick recap. What all we saw? We saw what is National Green Tribunal and the act under which it was established and the guiding principles of NGT, which is nothing but principle of natural justice. And finally, we saw that the decision of the tribunal has binding power, but also it can be challenged before Supreme Court. And after that, we saw the functions of NGT, which disposes cases relating to environmental protection, enforces any legal right relating to environment, and it gives relief in form of compensation for affected persons. And after that, we saw the composition, which included chairperson, judicial members, and expert members. And we saw some of the statutes covered under NGT Act. So with this, we have come to the end of our discussion. Let's move on to the next article. Now, let us take up this news article. It reports about a statement made by Union Culture Minister. As per the statement, the 1817 Paika Rebellion of Odisha is to be included as a case study in the Class 8 of NCERT history textbook. So the Union Culture Minister is saying that the 1817 Paika Rebellion of Odisha should be included in history textbook of Class 8. So this is the news here. Now in this context, let's learn about Paika Rebellion. So Paikas, meaning foot soldiers, were a class of military retainers. They were recruited by the kings in Odisha since the 16th century. The Paikas came from a variety of social groups, and they rendered martial services in return for hereditary rent-free land called Nishkar Jagirs and titles. So in exchange for rent-free land, which is called as Nishkar Jagirs, and for titles, they offered martial services. So to put it simply, they were peasant militias of Gajapati rulers of Odisha. These Paikas, they rendered military services to the king during times of war. And they were doing cultivation during times of peace. But this setup got disturbed with the arrival of British. Let me explain this in detail. See, the rulers of Kurda were the traditional custodians of Jagannath temple, and they symbolized the political and cultural freedom of Odisha people. In 1803, the Britishers, who had their influence over Bengal and Madras provinces, which is to the north and south of Odisha, occupied Odisha. And it was easy for them because Odisha is situated in the middle and Bengal is to the north and Madras is to the south of Odisha. And with their advent and colonial rule, they started to bring in new land revenue settlements. At that time, the Gajapati king of Odisha was Mukunda Deva too. But he was a minor then, so he couldn't do much. So the initial resistance against the British was carried out by Jai Rajguru. Rajguru was the custodian of Mukunda Deva too. But then this initial rebellion was put down brutally. And following this, the Paikas under Bakshi Jagabandhu rose in rebellion against the British in March 1817. And this rebellion was quite serious and it began spreading quickly to other parts of Odisha province. See, this person, Bakshi Jagabandhu, is the hereditary chief of the militia army of Gajapati King. And for this rebellion, they also took support from the tribals and other sections of society. They enjoyed support of the Rajas of Kanika, Kujang, Nayagar, Kumasar, as well as Jamindas, village heads and ordinary peasants. So these Rajas of Kanika, Kujang, Nayagar, Gumasar and Jamindas, village heads and ordinary peasants, they all supported Paikas in the rebellion against the British. During the rebellion, the Paikas attacked British symbols of power and they set fire to police stations, administrative offices and the treasury. The British were initially taken aback and they faced stiff resistance from the rebelling Paikas. However, at the end, British finally managed to defeat them within 3 months. The British suppressed this event by killing and imprisoning many people and many more were tortured. And the leader, Bakshi Jagabandhu, was finally arrested in the year 1825 and he died in captivity in 1829. See, this event holds great significance in Odisha. And the Paika Bidroha enjoys a cult status in Odisha with children growing up with the stories of brave fight against the British. And also know that the foundation stone for the Paika Memorial to commemorate the 200 years of Paika Rebellion is laid at the bottom of Barunai Hill in Odisha's Kurda district. So that's it for the article. Let's have a quick recap. We saw who are Paikas. They are foot soldiers who were a class of military retainers. So what did they do? They were offering martial services in return for rent-free land, which is called as Nishkar Jagirs, and for titles. They were the peasant militias of Gajapati rulers of Odisha. So what was the matter of contestation here? After the arrival of British, they, using the influence over Bengal and Madras provinces, occupied Odisha and started bringing in new land revenue settlements. So the Paikas, under the leadership of Bakshi Jagabandhu, rose in rebellion against the British. They attacked the British symbols of power and they set fire to police stations, administrative offices and treasury. But at the end, British managed to defeat them within 3 months. The leader was arrested in the year 1825 and he died in captivity in 1829. So the article is important from prelims perspective. With the learnt points in mind, Let's move on to the next article. Now let us take up this op-ed article. See, recently the National Family Health Survey, FHI, was released. According to it, the total fertility rate of India is found to be 2. And this particular article is written in this backdrop. See, the article here is basically an interview between two eminent persons. And they discuss the kind of approach to be adopted by our government when it comes to population control. Now, in this context, let us see the important points that are mentioned here. The syllabus covered by this article is highlighted here for your reference. First of all, let us have a brief understanding about total fertility rate, and then we'll move on to the main discussion. See, TFR, which is total fertility rate, is the number of children a woman would have in the course of her life. In other words, it can be defined as the average number of children that would be born to a woman if she experiences the current fertility pattern throughout her reproductive span, that is between 15 to 49 years. So in this period, in this reproductive span, which is 15 to 49 years, if we see how many children a woman is having, that gives you the fertility rate. Note that this indicator shows the potential for population change in our country. So as per the National Family Health Survey FHI, this TFR is said to be 2. And this marks a decrease from the 2.2 rate in the National Family Health Survey 4. So the total fertility rate has been decreased from 2.2 to 2.0 in National Family Health Survey 5. See, two main reasons have contributed to this decline. The first one is the unmet need for family planning as per the World Health Organization. To explain this briefly, know that women with unmet needs are those who are fertile and sexually active but are not using any method of contraception. Generally, such women report not wanting to have any more children, or they report that they are wanting to delay the next child. So this concept here explains the gap between women's reproductive intentions and their contraceptive behavior. For example, as per NFHS 4, women on average wanted 1.8 children, and it also said that one child is wanted per 8 women. This shows the extent of unmet need. The second contributing factor is education. At most instances, women with better education were found to have fewer children. This shows that education is the best contraceptive pill. See, education will help you take informed decisions. So it is very crucial to promote education to have a better population policy. See, this fertility decline is obviously a good sign, but it doesn't mark the end of our population policy. We'll see why is that. Because the population policy is not just limited to fertility control policy. It is also about mortality and migration. So in other words, it can be said that the three components of population growth are fertility control, mortality, and migration. So they all need to be focused holistically and equally. Whenever we think about population control, one major thing that comes to our mind is the population control law or drastic measures such as two-child norm proposed by Uttar Pradesh and Assam. The article here has thrown some light on this issue. According to the speaker here, India has to move away from such coercive population control measures. And to substantiate this argument, the speaker here gives two reasons. First is that this goal of population control can be achieved even in the absence of strict population control measures. For example, states like Kerala and Tamil Nadu have achieved the TFR of 2.0, and that too they have done this without coercion, that is without any strict measures. So if they can do it, even other states can also do this. So this is the first reason. Secondly, the reason is migration. See, in India, we have a lot of internal migration happening between different states. For example, migrants from Bihar and Uttar Pradesh are already moving to southern parts. This shows that the migration in our country can balance India's population even without strict population control policies. Moving on further, in the second part of the article, the speakers talk about some effective population policy measures and have to be adopted in the long run. Now let's see them one by one. See, in India, younger girls have least access to family planning services. This results in high teenage pregnancies. This problem should be addressed first. So in this regard, efforts should be taken to increase the age of marriage and also to promote women education, since it contributes to their own empowerment and growth. Like I said, education will provide you with information and help you take informed decisions. The second and the most important thing is family planning. See, India launched its National Program for Family Planning in 1952. And as per the speaker in this article, despite being the oldest family planning program, it fails to be the best or even an average program. The quality of family planning services needs a lot of improvement in India. Know that India's family planning program started with the cafeteria approach, which is nothing but you can go and ask them what they have and then you can choose from the available options. Just like going into the cafeteria and seeing what are the options available and choosing from the available options. But this is not the case now. At present, there is only sterilization and they hardly promote any other methods. So due to this, many couples are using abortion as a contraceptive method, despite knowing its associated health impacts. In fact, in India, the abortion-related mortality is close to 8%. Therefore, instead of just focusing on sterilization, we should make efforts to propagate temporary methods of contraception among men and women, like having a contraceptive pill or using condoms, etc. And we need to have more innovations in the family planning programs. And after that comes the need for a behavioral change. On that line, the sex education should be promoted. And awareness recognizing the overuse of female sterilization and its adverse impact on women health should be spread. And we should also start educating women, since some do not want their husbands to be sterilized. Then, as the speaker points, India has a strong preference for sons and a kind of aversion for daughters. This also leads to population growth. So this notion has to be changed. And finally, better budget allocation and careful spending of the allocated funds is also a viable option in this regard. So these are the most important measures advocated by our speakers here. So to conclude, we need to recognize that India is going to keep growing because of its young population, and these young populations need access to contraception more than family planning. And enabling that will help us achieve in converting family planning into family welfare. With this, we have come to the end of this article discussion. Let's have a quick recap. We saw what is TFR, which is total fertility rate. And TFR is nothing but the number of children a woman would have in the course of her reproductive span, which is 15 to 49 years. And we also saw that there is a decline in the total fertility rate compared to the previous National Health Survey, which is 4. And at present, the total fertility rate is 2.0 according to National Family Health Survey 5. And we saw the two major reasons contributed to the decline of the TFR discussed by the speakers in the article, which is the gap between women's reproductive intentions and their contraceptive behavior. And the second factor is education. So these two factors contributed for the decline in TFR. And we also saw the three components of population growth, which are fertility control, mortality, and migration. And following that, we saw why we should move away from coercive population control measures. Under that, we saw two points supporting the statement, which are even in the absence of strict control measures, population control can be achieved. Another one is migration That too in India, a lot of internal migration is happening between different states. So this balances the Indian population. And finally, we saw some effective population policy measures. Younger girls have least access to family planning services. That should be addressed. And the age of marriage should be increased. And women education should be promoted. And after that, we saw about family planning. And we spoke about the efforts to propagate temporary methods of contraception among men and women instead of sterilization. And after that, we saw about the need for a behavioral change. For that, education should be promoted and awareness about the adverse impact of women's health should be spread. And finally, as an effective population policy measure, we saw budget allocation and careful spending of the allocated funds as a viable option. See, that is one another important angle towards this whole issue, that is the replacement level, which is 2.1 as defined by the UN Population Division. Basically, it means that every woman has to have 2.1 children if a country wants to replace its dying population. For the first time in India, the total fertility rate is below the replacement level. We saw that the total fertility rate at present is 2.0, which is lower than the replacement level, which is 2.1. See, the trend of opting out is growing among couples nowadays, which means choosing not to have baby. It also has some scary consequences. We'll see what are they. Think about this. The lesser the number of babies, the lesser the number of people joining the workforce, and in turn, the lesser the output, the GDP, and the economic growth. Know that Japan is also facing such a similar problem. With the increasing older population and decreasing young population, 38% of the population will be people aged 65 and older by 2065 in Japan. It is also said that Japan has the highest amount of public debt in the world because of the low fertility rates and aging population. This is to finance the social sector schemes. And when it comes to China, China had the disastrous one-child policy in the late 1970s to limit the population growth. And again in 2016, it came up with two-child policy. And again in 2021, it brought up three-child policy. So instead of changing the numbers, what can be done by the countries is they can have more family-friendly policies, better government-run schools, make workplaces more flexible for mothers, and they can also enhance maternity and paternity leaves. And finally, they can acknowledge the decision of having a child is a matter of choice. So with this, we saw different angles of population control measures and population policy measures. With the learned points in mind, let's wind up this article discussion and we'll move on to the next part of our discussion. See, I have given here a couple of prelims questions so that we can practice what we have discussed so far. Let's see them one by one. The first question is, consider the following statements with reference to National Green Tribunal. Statement 1. The NGT's decision is final and there is no provision for appeal in the Supreme Court. Second statement is, NGT is a constitutional body. And the third statement is, the decisions of NGT are not binding. So try to recall and answer and analyze whether these statements are right or wrong. So try to recall what we have discussed in the article discussion and try to answer this question. And before that, read here, which of the statements given above is or are incorrect. So while addressing a question, you have to be very careful. See what they have asked. So here they have asked for incorrect options. So we'll discuss the statements one by one. The statement 1, the NGT's decision is final and there is no provision for appeal in the Supreme Court. We saw in our discussion that NGT's order can be challenged in the Supreme Court. So the statement 1 is incorrect. Coming to statement 2, NGT is a constitutional body. Think about it. Is it a constitutional body? No. See, NGT is established under the Act, National Green Tribunal Act 2010. So what does it mean? It means NGT is a statutory body. It is established under an act. So here statement 2 is also incorrect. The decisions of NGT are not binding. Here again we saw in our discussion that NGT's decisions are binding and it can provide relief also to the affected persons. So to summarize, all these statements are wrong. What is the question? The question is to identify incorrect statements. So all the above is the answer here. Option D, all the above is the answer here. Moving on, the next question is, in the context of Pica rebellion, consider the following statements. We'll go through the statement one by one. Picas were a class of cavalry soldiers recruited by the kings of Odisha since the 16th century. Picas rendered military service to the king during times of war and took up cultivation during times of peace. The Pikes under Mukunda Deva II rose in rebellion against the British in March 1817. So which of the following statements given above is or are incorrect? Here again, this question is about incorrect statements. So we'll discuss the statements one by one. Statement 1, they were a class of cavalry soldiers. Are they? No. They were foot soldiers. Cavalry soldiers are soldiers who fought on horseback. So Picas were foot soldiers. So this statement is wrong here. Second statement is, they rendered military service to the king during times of war and took up cultivation during times of peace. This statement is correct. We have seen this statement in the discussion also. The third statement, the Pikes under Mukunda Deva II rose in rebellion against the British in March 1817. This statement here again is incorrect because Mukunda Deva II, he was a minor then. So he couldn't do much. The Pikas under the leadership of Bakshi Jagabandhu, they only rose in rebellion against the British. So here statement 1 and statement 3, they both are incorrect. So what is the correct option here? It is option C, 1 and 3.
I've given here some mains questions for your practice. So interested candidates, please write it and post it in the comment section. I'll evaluate them. Also, if you have any doubts regarding the discussion or if you want me to discuss any topic, post that also in the comment section. I'll discuss them in the upcoming sessions. So with that, we have come to the end of our discussion. If you find the video useful, please like, share and comment, and do subscribe to the Shankar IAS Academy's YouTube channel for further updates. Thank you.